Picture this, I'm a bag of dicks. Put me to your lips, I am sick. I will punch a baby bear in his shit.
First off, fuck your bitch in the clique you claim. Westside, when we ride, come equipped with game. Used to be my homie, now you act like you don't know me. It's a case of divide and conquer, cause you let a Jew break up my crew.
You're like a kid, you found a puppy, now you're dapper. But tell me where the fuck you found the anorexic rapper.
I went from food stamps to fucking champ camps to hoes outside of hotels with fucking tramp stamps.
Fuck out of here. Yeah.
A common sentiment I see online is, I'm so tired of trash talk. Does anyone else just want to see these guys fight already? And that's fine. If you're into the sport and you don't need to know anything about the fighters to enjoy it, a good old beef doesn't do anything for you, good for you. You're a purist and I tip my hat. But I would never look down my nose at trash talk. For me, it's just another legitimate aspect of the fight game. Obviously, if you call it trash talk, it sounds trashy, or just plain stupid. But if you call it psychological warfare, if you look at it as, how can a guy use his words to break another man's will before they even step inside the fucking octagon? It doesn't sound so trashy then. On top of that, you know, all these fighters are clearly aware of one sobering fact. They all know that the sun will eventually set on the careers of them and every fighter in their era. And when that happens, some of them will ride off into that sunset as millionaires. Others will be broke as fuck, lamenting missed opportunities, looking for that one last fight. That's just the sad reality of the sport. And so if you look at it as, how can a fighter use his mouth to create opportunities for himself, to scratch and claw his way up a ladder, and ensure that when the writing's on the wall, when he's just got knocked out or beat down by some young up-and-comer, and all the pundits are calling for his retirement, that he is one of those guys riding off into the sunset? That don't sound so stupid to me. Colby Covington is the latest fighter to open his mouth and make a break for the good life. But before I get to Colby's trash talk, I want to quickly look at something he repeatedly mentions in interviews.
You know, it is what it is. They're going to have their feelings hurt. You know, this isn't the feelings business, you know. And I'm not here to make friends. I'm here to make money.
They got feelings. I don't have feelings or emotions. So that's the difference between me and them.
I'm just going to be like a robot. I'm not going to care what people think of me.
It doesn't hurt you when somebody says, I want ISIS to come and kill your family?
Not at all. I just kind of laugh at it. They get so emotional, you know, that they're into their feelings like a little girl.
Certain highly competitive cutthroat professions like lawyers and CEOs tend to have higher frequencies of sociopathic traits. I'd have to imagine politicians are in the same boat. Politics is a one profession so vicious, it make a fish fight look like a Thai massage with a happy ending. And it makes sense that guys who can take emotion out of the equation and give their own career precedence over any consideration for others are gonna be at an advantage in those ruthless arenas. The world of pro sports can be as ruthless as anything. I think guys like Lance Armstrong, Michael Jordan, and certainly some fighters exhibit sociopathic traits. Now, I'm not qualified to diagnose a guy, but without coming right out and saying it, Colby has basically diagnosed himself as at least having sociopathic traits. And I believe him, by the way. When he describes being ostracized by his teammates, he basically laughs in their fucking face.
Yeah, you know, the guys at the gym, they really took it personal. You know, I kind of got cut off from the Brazilians and American top team in the gym, and they don't train with me anymore.
He's got no remorse over hurt feelings. Doesn't give a fuck.
Yeah, no, I know. She was pretty pissed off about it. I'm pretty sure she blocked me on all social media outlets.
Oh, that's too bad.
They really take pride behind their country. They want an apology that I wasn't going to give. I said, hey, man, I'm promoting my fights. You know, if you got a problem with that, then you know where the door is. Yeah, I don't have no regrets, man. I'm who I am.
And you can clearly see that he does not give two flying fucks whether people love him or hate him. As long as he's getting the attention that's going to elevate his career and get him where he wants to go. Fans and haters alike are nothing more than dollar bills in Colby Covington's eyes.
Hey man, what kind of reception are you expecting in Chicago?
I'm expecting, you know, a little bit of both. Probably mixed reactions, you know, but that's more than most of the division can say. They're not getting the type of emotions that I'm drawing right now. So I expect some boos and some crowd cheers. So either way, it doesn't matter to me. I just love the hostile environment.
No, say whatever you want to say. Like, I don't block anybody on social media. You want to come over, you want to say you want me to die, you want ISIS to come get my family. I get those messages every day. So, you know, say whatever you want. Nothing's going to hurt my feelings. I'm not a snowflake.
I'm sure I'll gain some new haters, but, you know, the haters, they're my fans anyway. So definitely I'm going to gain some new fans.
When asked about what made him this way, he describes not fulfilling his wrestling potential.
I think just wrestling, not getting what I dreamed of and wanted my whole life. I wanted to be an NCAA wrestling champ, Division One. I fell short. You know, I got fifth. It was unacceptable. I should have won it that year. And I don't know. I had so much feelings, and I let it get to me so much, and I was so emotional about it. And I was just like, I'm not gonna be like this anymore. Especially coming into this business. This is not a business you want to have feelings. This isn't a feelings business.
So the guy's been dead inside for a while, and outside sociopathic traits, he got a chip in his shoulder. This might sound like I'm running Kobe into the ground, but I'm not judging the guy for the way he is, and this world has been shaped by sociopathic men with chips in their shoulder. Kobe might not make a good teammate, but if you're evaluating it from the perspective of clawing and fighting your way to the top of an incredibly cutthroat industry, those may very well be desirable characteristics, as evidenced by the fact that he's come out guns a-blazing, ruffled some feathers, and got himself a shiny new interim belt that shouldn't even exist. My point is this. Colby Covington seems uniquely suited to play the villain. Now all he has to do is convince the world to hate him. But hate is a strong word, and that begs the question, does Colby have what it takes to evoke such a strong emotion from the fans? Now, he has got some good lines, and I gotta admit, I find the ice-cold sociopathic demeanor to be quite funny. But he's a pretty basic button pusher. To use the internet slang, he's basically a troll. He uses a couple repetitive lines and hammers the same few angles over and over, and not in a very creative manner. So far, it's had mixed results. It got him a title shot, but doesn't appear to have moved the needle yet. But despite his obvious limitations as a trash talker, I honestly think if Colby can keep his win streak alive just a little bit longer, he's on the verge of something big. He could soon be riding a colossal wave of infamy. There is some intelligence behind the strategy he's using, but the brilliance of it isn't in what he's actually saying, which is mostly sophomoric, stupid fucking bullshit. It's when you step back and take a look at the bigger picture, you realize there's actually a lot going on here. But before I can do that, I gotta run through some of that sophomoric, stupid fucking bullshit.
My haters are all virgins and nerds.
They're a bunch of little geeks.
No one's safe. That's my gimmick, man. Nerdbash 2018. No nerd, no virgin is safe, so...
Nerds, virgins, Cheeto-eating dorks all come under the heading of Colby's campaign, Nerdbash. First thing I want to mention here is that Colby uses the word nerd as a term to describe anyone who criticizes him. So basically, he's using that as a synonym for the word hater. Now, I can't criticize that. Hater is one of the most tired-ass phrases trotted out by celebrities. Anything else is a fucking improvement. Also, there's a lot of people who have little names for their fans. Colby is more concerned with cultivating hate, so it makes sense to have some term of disdain. And why not turn it into a brand? But the term itself, Nerdbash, it kind of says a lot about Colby. You know, he refers to himself as the supervillain of MMA. But a lot of what he says is much more high school bully than criminal mastermind. I'll put it like this. If Biff from Back to the Future was a YouTuber selling merch, it would probably be called something like Nerdbash, Wedgie Time, Maverick, or some other stupid fucking bullshit. It really seems like his mind and his sense of humor never left 12th grade wrestling practice. When Colby was in college and they asked him where he wanted to be in 10 years, he probably said high school.
I will spoil movies for you. I will ruin your lives and your days and your weeks and your months. And you will be thinking about Colby Chaos Covington. I will be on your mind nonstop.
Another one of his favorite buttons to push is tweeting out spoilers for things like the Avengers and Star Wars. Now, I'm not really a Star Wars guy, but it's such a beloved franchise. There's people been religious fans for 40 fucking years. This was a huge movie, and the spoiler he tweeted was probably the biggest Star Wars spoiler since it emerged Darth Vader, fuck Luke Skywalker's mother. Now, I was never gonna go and see it, so I actually do fall into the category of people he saved 2.5 hours. But for those people who love Star Wars and were holding their breath for the latest installment, he basically ruined the fucking movie. This one is cut and dry, in my opinion, and there's really no other way to phrase it. Colby is simply being a fucking asshole for his own amusement and a little bit of negative attention. There's nothing funny or witty about it. And it really illustrates that all he cares about is attention. All he wants to do is push buttons and climb the ladder. When he says he doesn't care whether you love him or hate him, he is absolutely telling the truth.
Oh, I mean, South Florida is the home for the most beautiful women in the world. So, you know, I got a different girl on the schedule for each day of the week. I'm fighting a 5-round title fight versus RDA, so I got to make sure my cardio's up. So I've been putting in a lot of work in the bedroom, James. I'm going to be in great shape come June 9th. The threesomes and foursomes I've been having with just chicks is insane, man. I'm putting in 2 hours of work, just nonstop pressure and pace in the bedroom. So
another angle is his sex life. He's banging a lot of whores, and he liked to brag about it. He says he liked to brag about it because it antagonizes his critics, who, as I've mentioned, are all nerds and virgins. But the reason this is annoying is not because his haters are nerds. It's because most MMA fans are fully grown men. They're not 12. We don't need to hear about Colby Covington investigating the full array of sexually transmitted diseases. That's not on my to-do list. I didn't wake up this morning thinking, God, I wonder what Colby got last night. Hepatitis, syphilis. I wonder what prescription cream Colby Covington is rubbing on his genitals today. You know, Colby liked to give his rivals little insulting nicknames based on their personality. Choir Boy Thompson, Tyquil Woodley. I think if he applied that formula to himself, it'd be Colby Chlamiddington. On top of that, we already know. It's no secret that professional athletes, and especially stars, get laid. Ronaldo in a nightclub, if he even cast a sideways glance at a girl, she'd pull her panties down so fast they go through the fucking floorboards. If they don't catch fire on her burning loins. Guy's probably got a fire extinguisher in his fucking headboard in case one of them soccer sluts spontaneously combust all over the fucking place. Meanwhile, Colby's headboard probably got a taxi meter on it because you know them whores he got is charging by the fucking millisecond. And by the way, womanizing can be entertaining and funny if it's done with an ounce of wit or class. Remember Chael flirting with that beautiful reporter recently? Funny, lighthearted, just great.
Hello, sweet potato. What was the question? I was a little distracted. What'd you say?
My question was, what is your feeling now, Chael?
Pretty excited, as a matter of fact. But back to the fight.
Outside sports, Russell Brand spring to mind. You know, that guy, he might have about as much style as a dusty old cobweb draped across a fucking tombstone, but don't be fooled by his depressing appearance. He got game, and it's pretty entertaining to watch him reduce a smoking hot news lady to a quivering wet ball of lust using just some playful British charm.
Don't think about what I'm wearing. These things are redundant, superficial.
Okay.
Don't be distracted. What do you think that gesture means, the way you're touching that bowl? What does that indicate? What is that? What's the subtext of that?
I think we gotta go to break.
You need to lose that ring, Mika, because it don't mean nothing to you. She's grasping for the shafts. She's a shaft grasper.
But Colby just coming out and saying, hey, I fucked a couple of whores last night. Again, it just make him sound like he's stuck in high school. It kind of make him sound like a bit of a nerd who never got laid until his name appeared on a fucking billboard. Let's just say it doesn't work for me.
Brazil, you're a dog! All you filthy animals suck!
Another angle is calling Brazilians filthy animals. Now, I've been a little surprised by the reaction to this. It's alienated him from his Brazilian teammates. Verdum threw a fucking boomerang at him. You know, the fans are one thing, but I'm surprised his teammates can't just see it for what it is. Maybe they were just looking for an excuse to cut Colby out of their lives, but I think they could have given him a break on this. Anyway, all his yapping about Brazil, it didn't appear to move the needle for UFC 225. But it has got his name out there. It got a serious emotional response from some, and it got him a UFC belt. So whatever you want to say about it, this is one angle that has undeniably worked out for Colby Covington. I simply can't criticize him for this one. But if you look at Colby at this point, what has he got to work with? Not much. He's got a bunch of childish gimmicks, some of which were done before and done better. If you look at the characteristics that typically make a good trash talker, he doesn't really have them. He's not that quick-witted. Whenever someone takes him on directly, like Bisping or Usman, he tends to struggle. He's not spontaneous. One of the reasons you could watch Chael Sonnen and Conor McGregor interviews all day long is because you never know what they're gonna say. But with Colby, you do know. You know for sure that within two sentences, he'll be yapping about nerd bash, pussy, or filthy animals.
And Colby, how are you, sir?
Doing great, man. Just a fine South Florida day with a couple of my honeys.
Rinse and repeat over and over.
Colby, how are you?
Oh, I'm doing good, man. Got a good cardio workout this morning with two Midwest freaks, and I had to send him on the Magnificent Mile on the Walk of Shame.
He can be creative. I'll be honest, I find some of Colby's lines fucking hilarious.
What was your reaction when you found out about Fabricio Verdum's news?
I think it was, what comes around goes around. The boomerang that he tried to throw at me, you know, came around and knocked him out in London. He was unconscious, and then, you know, USADA came and woke him up, and, he tested positive for steroids like the filthy animal that he is. I do believe he will be on steroids in this fight, but it's not going to make a difference.
Doesn't bother you at all?
Doesn't bother me. I'll beat the steroids out of him in round one. I'll knock him out in round two.
But that creativity takes place behind closed doors. He come up with some good lines, but they never vary or evolve in front of our eyes. When the lights are on, his persona is static. And that might suggest that there's a limit to his gimmick. But Colby recently added one more string to his bow, a string that ties his whole persona together, and from a marketing and hype perspective, is nothing short of fucking brilliant.
I'm all about Trump. I want to go bring the belt to the Oval Office and put it on his desk, you know? Absolutely. I mean, it's a complete joke. The Philadelphia Eagles suck. The Golden State Warriors, they suck. I mean, what a joke. You know, you live in America. You're fed by silver spoons. You guys are a complete joke to American society. Yeah, you guys want to express your First Amendment and free speech, but, you know, you stand for this flag. You stand for the troops, the women and men that were brave and put their lives on the line so you guys could have your freedoms today. So I definitely want to bring the belt to the White House and see Trump.
In a cage, Colby Covington has used clever strategies to overcome opponents who, at least on paper, have more refined skill sets. And that's not a bad metaphor for what he's now doing with his mouth. We all know he supports Trump, but it goes way beyond that. Initially, I thought he was just a poor man's Chael Sonnen. But Colby Covington has modeled his whole title campaign and based his entire persona on Donald Trump.
They're bringing drugs. They're bringing crime. They're rapists.
Brazil, you're a dog. All you filthy animals suck.
And some, I assume, are good people.
No, I love Brazilian women, man.
I mean, I'd look her right in that fat, ugly face of hers.
That's not my fault. She looks like a horse-faced ratchet.
I called her a pig, a degenerate.
Sure. I just call her Miss Piggy, you know? Oh.
I tend to like beautiful women more than unattractive women.
Yo, I'm sevens and up only, Arios.
In the history of the world, nobody has gotten more beautiful women than I have.
Man, I got a different girl for every day of the week, but
I view a person who's flat-chested is very hard to be a 10.
You know, a girl that's a 7, she could look cute, but she could have no tits.
But it's not the chubbiness. Rosie is a very unattractive person.
Corner, your time.
I'd like to take some money out of her fat-ass pockets.
And frankly, I didn't want to put extra money in Amanda Nunes' bank account.
You are fake news.
The guy's a fake news machine.
First of all, very few people listen to your radio show.
Your podcast sucks. No one cares about it, man. No one wants to listen to that old fart fucking talk.
Look at Rubio. He's a lightweight.
He's a washed up little lightweight.
I watched him melt down.
RDA got melted by a featherweight.
We're going to win so much, you may even get tired of winning.
I'm the great American winning machine.
And you'll say, please, please, it's too much winning.
We're talking about real American great winning machine.
We will make America great again.
I'm going to make that place great again.
I treat women with great respect.
Giving the girl, you know, equal treatment.
Grab them by the pussy.
I will rule by grabbing these pussies and putting them in their place.
Is the president of the United States writing Colby Covington's lines? Trump, Colby, possible collusion. We'll have to get Vox Media to investigate the whole fucking thing. I mean, if Colby does get to the White House, Trump will probably adopt his ass. Colby be doing his next training camp from the fucking Oval Office. Chael Sonnen and Conor McGregor use spontaneity and quick wit. But Trump talks shit all the way to the White House, and he proved you don't have to be spontaneous or creative. If you just keep hammering out the same crude, blunt lines, they will find a home. Where do you think Colby got his idea for giving his big rivals little nicknames?
Lion Ted Cruz.
His name's Tyquil.
Little Marco.
Daryl the Doughboy can't make waves.
But you know, this poor, pathetic, low-energy guy.
GSP, that syrup-sucking Canadian.
Crooked Hillary, Crooked Hillary.
No one gives a shit about her and Ricky Pennington.
Sloppy Steve.
Ralphie Dos Nachos.
Little Rocket Man.
He's a coked-up little leprechaun, doesn't
they call her Pocahontas.
Choir Boy.
And so if you look at each one of Colby's angles on its own, it just looks stupid. But he is hitting some very specific notes and throwing salt on some fresh wounds. What are the labels thrown at Trump? Racist, xenophobic, sexist, misogynistic, and just generally offensive. Colby is singing the exact same tune in the exact same manner, right down to the fucking campaign slogans. As I said, hate is a strong word, but Colby doesn't have to convince anyone to hate him. All he has to do is stand between the American public and someone they already hate. If he can frame himself as a symbolic representation of Donald Trump and Trump's America, he may be able to tap into an enormous reservoir of pent-up rage, bubbling anger, and raw fucking emotion. In 2016, Trump stuck two middle fingers in the air and told half the world to go fuck itself. Then, he moved into the White House. Those wounds did not heal. The country is divided, bitterly so. And in 2018, Colby is pushing those exact same buttons all over again. And by the way, it is working. The MMA media are a largely liberal bunch. Colby says something offensive, and you can see their heads getting hot. If you listen closely, you can almost hear their brains popping inside their skulls like little bits of fucking popcorn. All Colby needs is some exposure, because the 2016 presidential race left a lot of people furious, lying awake at night dreaming about retribution. If Colby can step into Trump's shadow, then he can offer some of them the next best thing. A chance to see a Trump impersonator getting fucking stomped inside the octagon. Of course, they won't be thinking about it like that. All they'll be thinking is, I cannot wait to see this cunt get fucking mangled on live TV. And that's exactly what Colby wants. He's cultivating a hate base. Remember, the guy tweets spoilers to his own fucking followers. He's ridiculous. People like to call Colby an unoriginal copycat. But if his strategy works, it'll be interesting because of just how contrived it is. It'll prove that it's possible in a totally artificial manner to identify and manipulate a pre-existing reservoir of emotion in order to manufacture hype out of thin fucking air. Stuff the pain of a divided nation into a crude offensive package and sell it wholesale right back to the American public. Which, as far as gimmicks go, is just fucking brilliant. Hollywood does it all the time. The nationality of movie villains has varied over the decades depending on the prevailing geopolitical climate. Well, right now, for a lot of Americans, Donald Trump is a bad guy, and Colby has embraced his persona in a manner that would make the fucking Iron Sheik proud. Of course, it's all contingent upon winning. If he loses, his ability to antagonize a crowd evaporates. But if he can win a couple more fights and he keeps playing Trump's greatest hits, I think Colby can claw his way into that first category. He'll be a guy who talks shitloads of trash and then sail off into the sunset with boatloads of cash.
I'm the bad guy. I'm a super villain, but this is real life. Super villains and bad guys win in real life.